minutes. I'm still be talking.
What does Jeff Horn do from here?
As I said, we evaluate all the options. That's the key, is just look at all the options. We'll debrief, we'll analyze the fight, we'll see what he did right, what he did wrong. We'll look at every option that's possible on the table and try to select the best one for him that will drive him forward and keep increasing his brand. And he's only had 20 fights, remember, so it's still only early days. You have to remember that he never even turned professional until 2013. So he's only had a very brief 5-year career so far as a professional boxer. And to fight as well as he did tonight against, the best pound-for-pound fighter on the planet, I think that's pretty impressive performance.
Glenn, Terence was up there and he said there was nothing that Jeff did tonight that he didn't see coming. He said it was very predictable, he knew what was going to happen. I mean, what do you think? Do you think you surprised him in any way?
No, there was nothing Terence did either that I didn't see coming either. I think the fight unfolded about exactly as I thought. For some reason, Jeff was just slightly off his game. As I said, I don't know why, and I saw it after the first couple of rounds. I expected that he would have got out there and won that first couple of rounds, but they were very close, those first couple. We were going, don't know, they're just too hard to call. So we were looking carefully, and we just couldn't split them. There was just not much landing cleanly from either side. So I think it's only as the rounds wore on, Terence would just get that odd shot here and there, the clean one, when, he's just probably got the clean shot in this round. Bugger, it was really close till then. Just that little bit more, and as I said, it was more just a gear lower than he normally is. That's all I can put it down to, is one gear down.
Does it surprise you then that I think all three judges had an 80-72 at the time of the stoppage? Did you think Jeff won some rounds, or did you think it was...
I did, but that's not unexpected. I thought Jeff did have a couple of rounds there, which I would have given to Jeff, but I always know when you're away from your home, you've got to win your rounds more clearly to get those rounds. So that doesn't surprise me. I think the rounds are close. When the rounds are close and you lose them, you can't complain. Yeah, a lot of people complained in the Pacquiao fight. Yeah, but when rounds are close, you just have to accept whichever way the judges see it. So I'm not complaining about that. I'm just saying there was a number of those rounds. There's only a couple of punches here and there, but just the crisp, clean shots, and there weren't many of them. Terence would just get those couple of crisp, clean shots in the round. You go, that's frustrating. So a little frustrating, but as I say, that's boxing. We just have to live with that and learn from it.
Glenn, besides running into Terence Crawford just over here, and you mentioned something not quite right, can you put your finger on it a little bit more specifically? Something not quite right tonight? What went wrong?
He was sniffling when he was sitting in his room talking before the fight. He was sniffling, and I went, I'm not even going to mention it. I'm not going to say anything to him. Because if I start dwelling on it, saying, Jeff, you're all right or whatever, all I'm going to do is give that energy and give it focus. I didn't want to do that. But, we had a few issues, but these are things, his feet, problems with his feet. We're still sitting up the other night trying to bust his feet. He couldn't push off them. But, again, these things happen. He squirted me in the eye, actually, with all the fluid that came out of his toe the other night. Massive blister, but couldn't push properly. Did that affect him? Don't know. It's frustrating. You feel terrible because you don't want to make any excuses, but you always have to always debrief and look for the reasons. You've got to go, what was it? Is it because you couldn't push off on that right foot properly? Was that causing the issue? But just not quite as fast in as he has been in sparring. That's what I can tell you. He was normally a lot faster. And as Ray Robinson would say, you're just getting hit by Jeff normally before you can blink. But just... you take that little bit of speed off out of the feet and it makes a difference.
Just the referee stopping the fight at 2:33 into the round, you would have liked to have gone a little bit longer. Probably.
Absolutely.
That's a massive decision for you to make. A few people around, to be honest with you, that thought it was time. Would you say to that?
I didn't feel it was time because I knew that Jeff still had the energy and the power to finish him. And I thought that he was still very much in the contest. So even though, as I said, I'm not saying yes, Terence was winning the fight, but I just felt that Jeff was still in the contest. If I didn't think he was in the contest, I'd have been the first to stop the fight.
Has anyone
but I felt he was still
cards?
In the contest.
Anyone seen the scorecards from the judges?
80-72, Dino.
What's that?
80-72.
Okay.
All three.
Yeah. All right. Just spoke to Jeff. He's still getting some stuff done, but he's keen to come down. He might be 10 more minutes, but keen to front.
He will be here, and yeah.
How were the family after it, Glenn?
Look, the family were very upset, it's fair to say. But yeah, you'd expect them to be.
Yeah, okay. They're upset, but you know, again, you know, what more can you ask for from your son or your brother than to show that sort of courage and fight your absolute heart out? Not once did Jeff Horn say to me in the corner, hey, I've had enough, whatever. You know, we were focused all the way through that fight, and we knew we were still in it. He knew he was still in the fight. He asked me how many rounds to go, and he just knew, he just had to, and I was just trying to lift him a gear. And I thought, do I lift him now? Do I wait another round and really lift it and really put some pressure on Terence Crawford and just start banging him a bit and just see how big his heart really is? But just a shame we couldn't just land a couple of real big shots on him and just see how it could have changed the fight. We all know in boxing, one punch can change a fight.
I also went into Terence Crawford's dressing room just to shake his hand and tell him how gracious I thought he was in the ring afterwards. And, you know, he was, he said, would love to come to Australia. I said, to fight? He said, yeah, man, make it happen. Get us the money. Who knows? Who knows?
Hey, Glenn, how do you go about bringing Jeff back from a loss? This is uncharted territory for you guys. How do you go about rebuilding him now?
Well, one of my favourite sayings is, you know, if you're not strong enough to fail, you're too weak to succeed. Okay? If you can't handle a loss in life, we're all going to have losses, financial losses, we're going to have relationship breakdowns, we're all going to suffer, you know, defeat in life at some point. And you've got to be able to bounce back from that. You've got choices. You can either retire or you can be like Evander Holyfield said when he lost. What are you going to do? You're going to give it away? No, I'm going to get back in line. So like Evander, we're going to get back in line. You know, we're going to get back in line and we're going to rise and we're going to come back bigger and stronger. You know, it's that's the way it is. You've got the choices, run, hide, crawl inside a whiskey bottle, give it away, wonder what you could have done, or just man up, toughen up, harden up. You know, and that's what it's all about. That's what Jeff's spirit's all about. That's why I've taught him, is, you know, just to keep getting back up, and he will do that. Have no doubt whatsoever that Jeff will come back bigger and stronger than ever.
You said Terence has basically said, "Get me the money, get me to Australia." I mean, how realistic is that? I know you got Manny there, so it's always realistic. But
put it this way: we can put on a Manny Pacquiao Jeff Horn fight. We can put on a Terence Crawford Jeff Horn fight down in Australia. But there's more than, you know, to actually sort of ask that question straight after a fight and everyone's sort of fired up and what have you. There's a lot of things have to take place. You know, Bob Arum is a major contributor to what's going to happen next too. So, you know, and it comes down to what's the best option for Terence Crawford. You know, if Glenn tells me he wants to have a rematch, then I'll work my ass off to make sure that, or I try and make that happen. And, you know, Bob's going to be looking around saying, well, what are the options for us? What's the most amount of money? And what do I want to try and achieve? And what does Terence Crawford want to try and achieve? So I think incredibly gracious of Terence to be talking the way he is. And, you know, we're very, very thankful for it. And it's something we'll definitely pursue. So let's just wait and see. But I think there's a myriad of options out there. You know, there's some great welterweight fights happening. And for me personally, and this is just my opinion, the big money fights are going to happen at welterweight over the next sort of 3 to 5 years. I think there's a myriad of just great fighters out there, and the welterweight division's about to catch on fire. And who knows, you know, there's 5 or 6 fighters that could be just doing round-robin tournaments on a regular basis, and that's what the game needs right now to get some superstars in America, because right now there's only, you know, there's two on the rise. One of them's Terence Crawford, the other one's Vasily Lomachenko, but the real superstar right now is Canelo Alvarez, and we need 3 or 4 or 5 fighters up in the rear of fight air that he maintains from a revenue generation point of view, and I think the welterweight division's the hottest division in America right now, and that's where we want to be.
Just one thing on that, by the way, is I did say to Dean originally when he mentioned this fight, I would dearly, dearly have rather fought Terence Crawford in Australia. Just all those little bits, you know, the jet lag, all that sort of stuff. I wanted to fight him there, but unfortunately Terence's brand wasn't big enough, and Dean said, we just can't make this fight pay in Australia. That's the problem. He said he just hasn't, He doesn't yet have, he's a great fighter, but he just doesn't have the pulling power. He's not a Manny Pacquiao. People don't know him. As he mentioned, he doesn't talk a lot in the media, which is a shame, because if we would have had the fight in Australia, if we could have filled Suncorp Stadium with Terence Crawford, but the danger was that we bring him down there and lose a heap of money. So that was the problem. But we dearly wanted to have the fight in Australia, because after all, when you're the champion, you think, hang on, why am I going over into his backyard to fight, you know, if I don't have to? But, you know, it is what it is, and, you know, in the end, we had to come over here.
Having said that, thank you to the Australian media who come over here. You know, we had upwards of 30 guys here by the end of the fight. And due to the efforts you guys have put in, Terence Crawford is definitely a much bigger brand name in Australia than he was only 2-3 weeks ago. So, you know, potentially that would be an absolute reality, because I think there'd be very few Australians right now who don't know how Terence Crawford, who he is, and more importantly, don't know how good he is. Like, he's that's one hell of a fighter. And you guys have done an amazing job over the last week in particular, in the 6 or 7 weeks leading up. So if he's keen, we'd love to have a chat about it.
You mentioned all those great fighters in the welterweight division, but you almost need to be fighting in America to make that, to make yourself
work. It's about money, Rito, to be bluntly honest. If we can put the most money on the table, we'll make the fights happen. That's where we've got the Pacquiao fight. Bob didn't come down, the Pacquiao didn't come down to Australia and Queensland and Brisbane because they liked us. They came down because we put the most amount of money on the table. And if we think we can draw a big enough crowd and we can get global exposure for Brisbane and for Queensland, we will put up the most amount of money and we will make the big fights happen.
How marketable would a rematch be?
I think massively so. I think, you know, we talked about this, Glenn just touched on it, I touched on it before. It's a shame Terence doesn't talk in the media more, because he's actually really good when he does it. And I think he's got a hell of a story to tell. You know, I've read a couple of articles about stuff he's done over Wanda. Read some articles about how he's a great father. You know, he's obviously a great boxer and he actually loves fishing. So the guy's got some stories to tell. I just think he's very wary of the media for whatever reason. But I think if he could perform regularly in the media, because I actually think he's good at it, I think he'd become a superstar very, very quickly, because he's one hell of a fighter. And like I said, he's heading to the Hall of Fame. So the more he talks, the more money he's going to make. And I do think if he wanted to, we could raise the money to make it happen. But there's a lot of will has to go into it from one, Bob Arum, and two, Terence Crawford and BOMAC. Because I'm pretty sure the will will be on Glenn and Jeff's side, and certainly for mine anyway, as well.
Dino, if that, you know, Crawford's obviously got a profile in Australia now because of what's happened this week, but blokes like Thurman and Porter and those guys, they don't particularly have one over there.
You go back to the same problem, Rito.
Yeah.
You know, like all of a sudden, you know, Terence Crawford is probably the third most recognised fighter in Australia right now in this welterweight division. First would be Jeff Horn, second would be Manny Pacquiao, now you've got Terence Crawford. So we've built, and let's be honest, this is the business of sport, you know. Too often you look at all the things around and it's sport, but this is pure business. And with the amount of brand equity we've built around Terence Crawford and Jeff Horn, I think it'll be very easy to put a rematch together. And Australians love to back their own. And Australians love to back an underdog, you know, and Australians most importantly love to back a battler and a guy who's got the potential to win, and Jeff Horn's all of those things. So if Jeff was up for it, and Glenn was up for it, and the Queensland State Government was up for it, and Brisbane City Marketing were up for it, and I think they would be, and Terence Crawford was up for it, I'm sure we can make it happen. It just comes down to one thing, mate, where's the most amount of money, and that's what it's all about.
Yeah, the reason I was saying that was those other guys don't have that profile, so bringing them to Australia,
correct,
is not as lucrative.
So
right?
Crawford would be, of all the welterweights out there right now, he might even be more marketable in Australia than Manny Pacquiao, simply because he is a current WBO champ who just beat an Australian WBO champion. So I think of all the welterweights in the world right now, Terence Crawford is by far the most marketable in Australia. And it just comes down to, can it be made to work dollars and cents? And as Glenn said earlier on,